Okay, the today's lecture we are going to talk about iterative circuits. Of course, we are still in the domain of combinational circuits. Typically, many of these arithmetic circuits tend to be iterative in nature. Of course, apart from arithmetic circuits, there are also other circuits which could also be sometimes be made as iterative circuits. And we will see some examples of them and also see how to go ahead and design such circuits. A most common example of an iterative circuit is an adder circuit. I presume most of you would have already studied the design of an adder. So let me just go over it briefly. So what we have over here is a 1-bit full adder over here. This 1-bit full adder has 3 inputs. So the inputs are AI, BI, which correspond to the ith bit. And we have a carry input coming from a previous stage, which is called CI minus 1. So I am assuming that CI minus 1 corresponds to a bit which has a lower weightage, or it's of lower significance than the ith bit. So that's a CI minus 1 input that's coming in. And then we have an output. There are 2 outputs. There is a carry output to the next stage. And we have a sum output coming out of this 1-bit full adder. So this is a very simple circuit, and the sum output, basically the sum is 1 if the number of 1s among AI, BI and CI minus 1 is odd. That is, if they are either one of these 3 is 1 or all 3 are 1. So that's expressed by AI exclusive or BI exclusive or CI minus 1. So if 2 of them are 1, the sum will be 0, but carry CI will be 1. If all of them are 0, again the sum will be 0. If either one of them or all 3 of them are 1, the sum will be 1. So that's a Boolean equation, and you can realize it using exclusive or you can translate them into any of the other components, NANDs, NORs, ANDORs, and so on. When you look at the carry output is 1 under 2 when at least 2 of these 3 inputs are 1. So that's expressed by AI, BI. If both of them are 1, then this is 1, and carry output is 1. Or if either one of them is 1 and CI minus 1 is 1. So if the carry in is 1 and one of them is 1, again. Of course, here it does not matter whether you use an exclusive or whether you use an OR, because an OR is only implies that this particular minterm is going to be included over here as well. When both of them are 1, this particular term, not minterm, sorry, this particular product term is going to be included here with an OR, but whether if, because anyway, when both of them are 1, CI is 1, it doesn't matter. So again, I can realize this using some, what we are today concerned about is, given this 1-bit cell, given this 1-bit full adder, I can make an n-bit full adder. I can add any n-bit numbers. The only thing I need to do is to make n copies of this particular cell and cascade them. Take the carry output from one cell and put it to the next cell and so on and so forth. If I do that, so what I will have is a n-bit full adder. So what it really requires is basically n of these cells. And this goes, so, and if I consider this, so I have 2 inputs to each one of these cells. So if it is an n-bit addition, so this is A0, B0, this is A1, B1, this is AN-1, BN-1, and I have output. So I have an output, some 0, some 1, and some N-1. And this carry that comes out of this, so in this case it's CN-1, of course, with the nomenclature we are using the C-1. The carry that comes out of this has to be considered along with this. So there's one additional output. So when you're adding n-bit numbers, I have to be prepared to get an n+1-bit output. But you can see that it's very easy to construct this structure once I have designed a 1-bit cell. And such structures are called iterative structures. What you do is you design one cell and make multiple copies of them to realize a full functionality or a larger functionality. Later we will see that when you do the designs of certain circuits, you know, using certain tools, you also have a capability of doing what's called generic designs. You can define a methodology for generating an n-bit adder, given a 1-bit adder, and a user can specify what is the value of this n, and on the fly, one can synthesize or one can generate an n-bit adder. Because I know that how do I put up number of these copies of this to actually generate an n-bit adder, so I can use the methodology to generate an 8-bit adder or a 16-bit adder or a 32-bit adder. There are some problems with it, and we will address these problems as we go along. Now let us look at another example of it. This is again an arithmetic circuit, and it's a comparator circuit. It's a fairly simple 1-bit comparator, and we can just argue out the... So again I am doing a comparison, an i-bit comparison of numbers, and let us say they are unsigned numbers or positive only numbers. So if a number has a 1 at a higher, in a more significant location, where the other number has a 0, then it will be greater. And now this particular comparison, as far as the comparator is concerned, unlike an adder, you can do a comparison starting from LSB to MSB or MSB to LSB. So this is a case where we are cascading, that is, we are taking the carry inputs. These three, in a very generic sense, these are called carry inputs, and these are carry outputs. Carry is not just used for adders. When you talk of iterative circuits, we just talk in terms of carry inputs coming from a previous cell to the next cell. And I have a 1-bit AI and BI. So now if I look at it, so I have three inputs over here, GI minus 1. What GI minus 1 defines is, basically it defines whether till the I minus 1th bit, number A is greater or B is greater. EI minus 1 will define whether till the I minus 1th bit, the numbers are equal or not. And similarly, LI minus 1, whether A is less than B till the I minus 1th bit. And given this information, and given the value of these bits AI and BI, what I am required to define is what the output of this is going to be. Because it's very clear in an iterative structure that I can actually define this GI, EI, LI in terms of these five inputs. I have five inputs over here. I've done my job because I just need to make copies of this for any number of bits and I can be. So now let's look at how it is defined. I can simply write down this Boolean equation, just arguing it from basics, that this is going to be equal. First of all, remember, in this case, these three inputs are mutually exclusive. Similarly, these three outputs are mutually exclusive. What it means is only one of them can be high. The output input has to be of the type 100, 010 or 001. Similarly, the output has to be of the type 00100010 or 001. Not more than one output or not more than one of these inputs can be 1. So now, equality condition is, all the bits have to be equal. So that means, till now, EI minus 1 should be 1, and these two bits should be equal. And these two bits are equal under these two conditions. AI complement, BI complement means both of them are 0, or both of them are 1. So, till now, all the bits are equal, and this bit is also equal, then EI minus 1 is, EI is 1. GI, I am going from LSB to MSB. So what it means is, if these two bits are different, AI and BI are different, that is AI is 1 and BI is 0, then irrespective of what the inputs are, I don't have to really care for the inputs, my output GI is going to be AI is 1 and BI is 0, so this term is going to be 1 and my GI is going to be 1. In case these two are equal, I will say that GI is 1 if GI minus 1 is 1. If no decision can be taken at looking at this bit, then I have to look at the inputs, carry inputs to take the decision. And that's what is happening over here, that I take the look at the carry bit, carry input bit, so that is GI minus 1 is 1, and these two are equal, then it is 1. Or, of course, if these two are different. Similarly, in case of less than, okay, this was wrong. Okay.
So it should be AI bar and
OBI. Yeah. it should be AI bar BI, not AI. So if AI is 0 and BI is 1, and if the decision, so of course in this case, this will be less than LI will be 1. Or alternatively, if these two are equal, then if LI minus 1 is 1, then LI should be 1. So this is of course a cascading that is being done from LSB to MSB. We can very simply, let's say we could also choose a comparator to be of a different type. I can define a comparator which actually goes, is cascaded MSB to LSB. So I have, let us say, GI, EI, LI, GI minus 1, EI minus 1, LI minus 1, and AI, BI. And so I can write down my equations. I can now GI minus 1 . So now what will happen over here is, because I am going from MSB to, if the decision has already been made, then I don't have to make any decision over here. But if no decision has been made, that is, if the decision is that till now they are equal, then I will look at AI BI complement. This is E. If EI minus 1, of course EI minus 1 doesn't change, it has to be EI, AI complement BI complement plus AI BI. It has to be equal till now and equal at this particular bit. And LI minus 1, if a decision has already been made that the number is less, then I don't have to really do anything. But if that till now the numbers are equal, then I have to make the decision. So in both these cases, the comparator, when it was cascaded from LSB to MSB or MSB to LSB, I have written down this Boolean equation just from arguing it from basics. Like, because I understand the binary numbers and I understand when they are greater than equal, and I have done it. So sometimes you can do it, sometimes you have to follow a combinational design methodology. You can arrive at the same result by actually writing a truth table or using Karnaugh map, or later on, as we will discuss, other techniques of doing it with 5 inputs and 3 outputs. For each of the 3 outputs, I can write down the canonical form, sum of products, sum of min terms, and then do the minimization, and then I can arrive at the same result. But again, the key thing to be emphasized over here is, once I have designed this cell, I can take a lot of efforts to design this cell. I can try to minimize this area, because the advantage of doing that is, once I have done it well for one cell, I can build any size comparator using this cell by just repeating it. So these are the two arithmetic circuits that we discussed. Now let us look at some other interesting circuits which can also be built in the same manner. So here I am talking of a 1-bit cell for a circuit. It is a string of binary, string of zeros and ones which are given. And what we are interested in finding out is the number of ones are even or odd. That's the problem that I am trying to solve. Detecting number of ones in a pattern is even or odd. So my final output, which I call a CI, one if number of ones among A0 to AI is odd, 0 otherwise. This is the problem that I am trying to solve. And I want to make a combinational circuit. Later we will talk of solving such problems using sequential circuits also. But in this case, my idea is to make a combinational circuit. And I am also interested in making an iterative circuit. So what I am interested in is to design one cell, 1-bit cell, and which this cell can be repeated over and over again. So as this problem, so what I have discussed over here, is if you look at it, what I really need to generate is CI based on the fact CI minus 1. CI minus 1 has the same definition as CI, except that the index is I minus 1. So what it means is CI minus 1 is going to be 1 if number of 1s among A0 to AI minus 1 is odd and 0 otherwise. So now, if I remember that this is my definition of CI, and finally the output that comes is nothing but the carry that is coming from, or the seed that is coming from the last stage. Because after all, I am interested in detecting whether the number of ones is odd or even. So looking at this bit that is coming from the last stage or the last cell, I will be able to say whether the number of ones are even or odd. How do I do it? It's fairly straightforward. So let us, I have to define, in this case there are two inputs. CI minus 1 is one input. AI is another input. And CI is the output. See, there are lot of problems in this type of iterative circuit design. It relates to deciding on the definition of the carry inputs. Once you define that, give a good definition of the carry input which is appropriate to the problem, rest of the problem simply boils down to combinational circuit design. So in this case, if I know that CI minus 1 is 1 bit, CI is also 1 bit, and I can write down so if CI minus 1 is 0, what is the implication? CI minus 1 is 0 means number of 1s from 0 to I minus 1 is even. If number of 1s from 0 to I minus 1 is even, and if my AI is also 0, that means number of 1s will remain even. So I don't have to do, my CI is going to be 0. If number of 1s from 0 to I minus 1 is even, but my AI is 1, so the number of 1s are going to become odd. So my output is going to be 1. If number of 1s till now were odd, and now this is 0, so obviously it will remain odd. If number of 1s till now were odd, and now AI is 1, it's going to become even. So I'm just doing if it is even and if I receive an 1, then it will become odd. If it is odd, if I receive a 1, it will become even. But of course in case of a 0. So this particular function, you can even visually see that this is nothing but an exclusive OR function. So it's an exclusive OR function. And so what I need is, basically if you now look at the circuit that needs to be formed, is fairly straightforward. I need a circuit like this. Each cell is nothing but an exclusive OR. And so on. So each one is, this is the cell that we are talking of, the iterative cell. And if I have a set of exclusive ORs, and of course we know that the way we generate parity, this is what we do, okay? So it's no different from a parity generator, but we have derived it starting from. So the idea was to design an iterative structure, and we have generated an iterative structure for doing that. Let's look at a slightly more complex problem of pattern matching or pattern recognition. And here I define, one can take any type of a pattern and do that. And I am defining a pattern over here. It is a 4-bit pattern, 1101. This is what I am interested in, finding out whether such a pattern exists or not. How many times, I will of course very precisely define what my output is required to be. I have an input string and I need to generate an output string. Both of them are strings, and here in this case, because we are doing an iterative design, I am not really concerned about what the length of the string is. That's the advantage of doing an iterative design. I can, once I have done my design, I can later on implement this for any size. I can implement it for 8-bit, 16-bit, 32-bit or 37-bit. It really doesn't matter. So now, if you say that 1101 is my pattern, so yi is going to be 1. Under what condition? If xi, xi minus 1, xi minus 2, xi minus 3 is going to match 1101. So that means, at the ith bit I have 1, I minus 1th bit I have 1, I minus 2 bit I have a 0, and I minus 3 bit I have a 1. If I have this particular sequence, any time such a sequence occurs, then my yi is going to be 1. But if such a sequence does not occur, then my yi is going to be 0. And you can see that it's moving window type of a thing. Basically, at any ith bit, you have to look at the xi and you have to look at the previous 3 bits each time. And when you go to the next bit, you again have to look at that bit and the 3 previous bits. So you will, of course, drop the fourth one, which you look for the previous ith bit. So, for example, just to clarify this, so if I have a particular sequence, let us say this is the pattern, and let's say I start from this being x0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So this is x10. So now, if I look at the y, my y0, of course, because I don't have anything over here, first 3 bits have to be 0. Okay, the way I have defined it. So these 3 bits cannot be 1. But now if I look at y0, y1, y2, y3, I will check whether the pattern 1, 1, 0, 1 exists. It doesn't. So this will be 0. Again, I will check whether 1, 1, 0, 1 exists. It doesn't. So this will be 0. When I come to this 1, 1, 0, 1 exists, so this will be 1. Now if I look at this bit, it is 0, 1, 1, 0, so this will be 0. 1, 0, 1, 1, this will be 0. 1, 1, 0, 1 exists, so this will be 1. And then this will be 0, and this will be 0. So I have been able to detect twice this pattern. Later when we talk of sequential circuit design, we will talk of a lot of variations of this. But anyway, in this case, we do permit overlap of the patterns. For example, this one is being shared between two patterns, between this pattern as well as this occurrence and this occurrence. So what I am interested in is basically designing a cell which takes this xi and generates this yi. Of course, it can take some inputs. Okay, so if I want to, depending on how you, the direction I have proceeded in this manner. So it will take some inputs. I do not know how many inputs, which I call as carry inputs, and it will generate some outputs. So one output, of course, is the y output, another output as a carry to the next higher bit. Here, of course, the higher and lower is not really important. We are not giving any weights to these, but to the patterns, but essentially the way we are matching the pattern is important. So if I have this, can design this cell, I can design a cell for doing this specific matching this pattern or recognizing this presence of this pattern in the string. So now what is that? So the important thing, as we said before, is to be able to get a definition of what these carry inputs are. In case of patterns, it's again very standard way of defining this carry, and let me give you an example. Continue with the example that we are considering. I need to distinguish between, let us say, the pattern that has emerged till now in 4 different ways. If no match till now, that is till the I minus 1th bit, there has been no match, then the 00 is only an encoding. We can also talk of other ways of encoding in a moment. But let us say that I need to say, I call this S0. S0 means no match. S1 means one bit has matched till now. I got the first bit. The first bit is 1101. The first bit is 1. So I got a 1. 10, if 2 bit matched till now, let us say that is S2. And 1-1 if 3-bit match till now. So that means, I say, it is S3. 4-bit match need not be stored, because when you say the 3-bit match has occurred, then I am looking at the present bit to say whether the pattern has matched or not. Because the pattern length is 4 bits, I need to only have to bother about S0, S1, S2 and S3, which gives me the number of bits that have been matched till now. So when I say that, so basically I have to, starting from the CI minus 1 definition of this, I have to generate the CI, and that is how my cell is going to be designed. Now, of course, when we said that S0, S1, S2, S3, so that's the information that is getting encoded in this CI minus 1 and CI. In both of them, this is the information that's getting encoded. How I encode this information is fairly up to me. I can choose 2 bits to encode it, or I can even choose 4 bits to encode it. In this case, I've chosen 2 bits to encode it. So please distinguish between the fact that the information that needs to be stored is S0, S1, S2, S3. Later in sequential circuits, we'll define them to be the states of the machine. But here you can say that this is the information. So basically the information that needs to be passed on to the next cell is the fact that how many bits have matched till now. This is the information that I need to pass it on. And once I have passed that on, so now looking at the bits that I am getting now, that is XI, I can now generate the information whether the match has progressed, whether I have been able to match more bits or the match has not progressed, where I am going. So I can choose actually 4 bits for it, and I can encode them as 0001001001000 and so on and so forth, any manner I can encode. But for reducing, let us say, the number of bits that need to go from one cell to the other cell, I have chosen a 2-bit encoding. So I encoded this information in 0001001. Once I have done that, the design of the cell is fairly straightforward. What I really need to do now is basically nothing but write down this table. What does this table contain? It defines the two outputs, CI and YI, in terms of CI minus 1 and XI. CI minus 1 is the input information, how many bits have matched. And CI is the information, including this ith bit, how many bits have matched. This is up to I minus 1's bit, how many bits are matched. And XI gives you the bit value. And YI, of course, is the output of the cell. So now, let's write down here the pattern. The pattern that I was looking for is 1101. And let me also draw the cell. It is CI minus 1, CI, XI and YI. Now let's look at each one of them. If no bit has matched till now, CI minus 1 is 0, 0, and if I get XI to be 0, the first bit that I am looking for is a 1. So if I get a 0 over here, I will say no bit has matched, so I will still give 0, 0. But if no bit has matched till now and I get a 1, that means my first bit has matched, and so I will give 0, 1. And if by 1 bit has matched, so this 0, 1 is not a pattern, please remember this is the encoding of the fact that 1 bit has matched till now. And if I get a 0, that means now 2 bits have matched. 1 has already matched and now 0 has come, so I will give 1, 0. But if I get a 1 over here, 1 bit has matched, so previous bit was 1. And now again I get a 1, so obviously 2 bits are not matched. I am starting a new match and I will give a 0, 1. This is because of the fact that if I have a pattern in which 1, 1 comes, so I already said 1 bit has matched, but when I get a 1 again, I cannot say 0, 1 it has matched, so I basically have to say that I am starting a fresh match, and so I will just give, so for 0, 1 I will give 0, 1 if 1 gets. Now if 2 bits are matched, 1, 0, and I get a 0, but now I am 2 bits are matched means basically I already got 0, 1. What I am looking for is a 1. But if I get a 0, then I will go back and say that no bit have matched. And now if I get a sequence 0, 0, 1, I have to go back and say that no bit has matched, and that's why 0, 0. But if I get a 1, if I get 101, that means I will go and say that 3 bits are matched. And that's why I will give 11 over here. And if this 11 and 0, basically a 11 and a, so that means 3 bits were matched and I get a 0, so I have to say that 2 bits are matched, because I am getting, if you get a sequence like 0101, I will go back and say only 2 bits are matched, and that's why it's 10 is. And 11 and 1 will give me a 1 bit has matched, because this particular, so I have 1101, and so this one can be taken as part of the next pattern also, that's why 01. But if you look at the output, the only time the output will come 1 is when 3 bits are matched and the present bit is 1. And so by defining this, so you can actually, what you can do is you can write this table not in terms of zeros and ones. You can also write this table in terms of S0, S1, S2, S3. That's even simpler, because here you may be confusing them with the patterns, and you just write in terms of symbolically, in terms of the fact that how many bits are matched. By looking at the XI input and how many bits are matched till now, I can generate how many bits have, what will be the output of this. So once I have drawn a table of this nature, the rest of it is, as we said, is fairly mechanical. And I have a cell that defines this particular. I have now split them into two parts, because they are two bits. So I am defining CI1 and CI2. And what I am receiving is CI-1, 1 and CI-1, 2. And if you look at this table, I have converted them into a sum of min terms. And the reason I have done it is, the way I have done it is, you can see that there are three variables over here, three inputs over here, XI, CI-1, 1 and CI-1. So this actually is CI-1, 2 and CI-1, 1. And I have, so I can write it in terms of min terms 0 to 7. This is 3 bit and I have written it in terms of 0 to 7. And I can write it in this term. And actually CI1 in this case, simple case, actually reduces just to XI. Okay, so that's a very, and CI2, one can do a minimization. And YI is nothing but only one min term is present. So that's just CI-1, 1 dot CI-1, 2. Dot XI. So, but of course, one can synthesize the logic that is required for this. And once I synthesize the logic that is required for this, I can put any number of these cells and do a pattern recognizer for this particular pattern. So, what we have considered now is a systematic method of, given a pattern, I can design a cell, and this cell can be iterated over number of times to do a pattern check for a large number, large string. But there are certain issues connected with designing an iterative cell like this. And we will consider both these issues. One is related to the boundary cells. What happens is, of course, if you are doing a design, you want to design, obviously, a regular pattern structure. In terms of today's technology, regular structures are always preferable. Okay. But then, once the structure is large, and then if, let's say, if you are implementing actually in a VLSI domain, if you are actually going to integrate it within a circuit, you also look for simplifications. And there are a lot of simplifications that are possible, essentially in iterative structures, essentially related to the end cells, to the boundary cells. So let us look at, in both cases, so in all these cases, if you look at what is the simplification that is possible in the adder circuit, in the comparator circuit, in the pattern recognizer that we have considered. If you consider the adder circuit, and if you really are not designing a modular adder in which you don't really care whether there is a carry input coming to the LSB or not, if there is no carry input that's coming to the LSB bit, the least significant bit. So that means you basically need to use only a half adder, not a full adder. That means you have to only look at the two bits, AI and BI, to generate both sum and carry. sum is going to be nothing but AI exclusive OR BI, and carry is going to be nothing but AI dot BI. You don't have to, so you can simplify the logic. Remember the logic that we had for the and in this case, if I can simplify the logic, so I don't have to take the exclusive OR of these 3 bits, I can take an exclusive OR only of these 2 bits. And similarly, I can ignore this, because basically if you say CI minus 1 is going to be 0 here all the time, so my this will get eliminated and this will get eliminated. So I will have only these two. And this such a circuit is called a half adder. So for the first bit, you need to have only a half adder. So this is a boundary cell and which can be simplified. Let's look at the comparator case. We had, it's possible in both the comparators, but let us look at the comparator that we first designed. When I'm talking of the least significant bit, here the cascading is from LSB to MSB. If you're talking of the least significant bit, this is going to be 0. This is going to be 0 and this is going to be 1. We have to essentially simulate as if the comparison process till now has resulted in the two numbers being equal. So if I make these substitutions, if I say that GI minus 1 is 0, LI minus 1 is 0, EI minus 1 is 1, if I make this substitution, these equations will get simplified.
So you're talking about the first cell, right?
Only the first cell. Because for the first cell, these three are these are not actually any inputs. The known inputs are required. These inputs are going to be constant values. So the constant values that I need to substitute are 0, 1, 0. In these equations, if I substitute 0, 1, 0, the equations themselves will get simplified. So that means the logic associated with this particular cell can be simpler. Very similar to in case of an adder, the carry into the least significant bit is 0. Similarly, because EI is 1, so this will get eliminated. EI will be defined as just this. It is basically an exclusive NOR. And because GI minus 1 is 0, this is going to get eliminated. GI is for the first cell. So this only I am talking of. So this is will be the GI. Similarly, for LI, this will be the LI. This will get eliminated. So I do get a certain advantage in terms of the first cell. When we consider this pattern matching example, here things are even more interesting, because here what happens is, it is not just the first cell which gets simplified, but actually the first 3 cells get simplified. Because for first cell, the only input I have is no match till now. If you consider the second cell, I have 2 possibilities of the match. I have a match of no match or 1-bit match. If I consider the third cell, I have 3 possibilities, no match, 1-bit match, 2-match, 2-bit match. And when I consider the fourth cell, then I have the full possibilities. If you consider in terms of those S0, S0, S1, S2, S3. So if you consider those CI inputs, the CI can take all possible values only for the fourth cell. For the first cell, second cell and third cell. So whatever equations you have derived, by minimizing this truth table, now you have to derive, for the boundary cells, you have to do a minimization in a different way. Basically, if you consider the inputs, if you consider the least significant bit of this pattern, or the first bit of the pattern, these are going to be don't care. Because when I consider the first bit, obviously I cannot say 3 bits are matched. How can I say that? So this input cannot occur. If you remember the don't care situation, we said that the don't cares occur because certain input combinations cannot occur. So in this case, for the first bit, these pattern input combinations cannot occur. And once we put don't care, obviously the logic is going to get minimized. Similarly, when I consider the second cell, I will have some don't cares. I will have these 4 rows will have don't cares. And when I consider the third cell, these 2 rows will have don't care. Only when I consider the fourth cell onwards, I will have this particular logic requirement. In case of the output also, I don't need any output. Actually, I don't need that AND gate, 3 input AND gate, which ANDs these 3 for the first 3 cells, because the output is going to be 0 irrespective of what the inputs are going to be for the first 3 cells. The pattern is of size 4, so obviously I need at least 4 bits to start my pattern matching. So these are some of the simplifications that are possible, and depending upon the situation, you can simplify sometimes just one cell. Of course, in all these cases, we only simplified the cells on the starting of the pattern matching or LSB bits. There are situations where you can also simplify the most significant bits. That all depends upon the problem domain. Okay, so this is where we will stop. In the next lecture, we will consider how do we speed up iterative circuits. Because one problem that we find before we, let me just motivate you to this problem. One major problem that we find with iterative circuits is the delays that are associated with iterative circuits. Please, quiet please. So when we talk of, silence please. When we talk of circuits of this nature, as we increase the number of bits, the problem that we'll face is the delay is going to keep on increasing. I have a certain delay associated with the cell, and if I increase the number of bits, because I have so many cells, the number of the delay is going to get increased. So there are techniques by which we can look at reducing the delays, and this is a problem we will consider. Thank you.